Hello, everybody. Welcome to Loretta McNary Live, Loretta McNary Show. And depending on what time you're watching this, it could be mornings with Loretta. Yes. So let me tell you about this show. Let me kind of set this up because I want you all to just relax, because what's going to happen, I want you in full authority of what you're going to experience. I can tell you it's going to be an array of emotions, because I heard and saw LeJuene Thompson perform in Atlanta a few weeks ago. And let me tell you, I already told her I'm not a fan of many people, because I get to interview people all the time, right? I'm usually friends, or I'm just appreciate their talent immensely. But this lady, I can truly say I'm a fan of her. So welcome, LeJuene Thompson and Cedric Thompson, to the show.
Thank you for having us.
And I kind of want to tell them, so LeJuene, you are a vocalist, you are a musician, you're an actress, you like this triple threat, and you're an entrepreneur, right? So we're going to talk about all that. And then Cedric, he is mildly fitting in with her, wants her light to shine today, but he is a Grammy Award winner music producer, and also a Stellar Award music producer. And we'll talk about that. So anytime two people that are you are one in the union, I say you're a power couple, because you're making power moves and you can truly see God's goodness on you. So I want to kind of just start with you. How did you even meet Cedric? Was it in music? Was it in church, choir?
It is hilarious. The story is hilarious. So I'm going to give you the abbreviated version. I started singing with Pastor John P. Key when I was 12 years old, and I think I was around 16. Cedric had gone to Johnson C. Smith University for school, and Pastor Key would have rehearsals right down the street from Johnson C. Smith. So I wasn't there for a few months, and then I came back and saw this young man whom I did not like at first because I thought he was arrogant. However, he just, you know, we started dating, and he told me one time we were riding through the mountains, he said, "You will be my wife." And it was just hilarious because, again, I didn't like him at first, but he.
Oh, has, wow. Okay. What a story. What a story. So.
Yeah.
How many years ago?
34
years.
We've been married for 34 years. We will celebrate.
You're going to say like 10 or 8 or something. 34 years.
No, 34.
You meet him and you think he's arrogant, right? And you wouldn't want to have anything to do with him.
Like you. I really did at first. But I think the fact that he was so confident, I was like, he's too arrogant for me. But it wasn't arrogance. He was just confident in who he was. It was just hilarious. The first few weeks were just, it was funny. So we did.
Cedric, I want to hear your spin, because it's usually the same story experienced by two people, but a different spin on it. Can you share your part, your side?
Pretty much the same thing. You know, we, ironically, I had already heard her voice even before I met her, you know, so for me to put the voice with the face, you know, I was like, it didn't match, you know, because her voice was so, I mean, it was so, even at that time, it was so seasoned, you know, so when I met her, you know, likewise, we didn't kick it off.
So that part, you sticking to that part of the story?
Oh no, that part. Yeah. That part was sticking too. And, I remember we were in the store somewhere, and
we were in Kentucky.
I started liking her, and one of the singers, Tina Morrison.
Yeah, God rest her soul.
You know, I asked her, you know, to kind of start help me kind of break the ice a little bit. You know, so from there, you know, we started communicating in the whole nine, and likewise, I knew, you know, she was the one, and that she was going to be my wife. And that's true. You know, I told her, as a matter of fact, the way I told her, I said, "Your last name is going to be Miss Thompson."
Yeah. He told me.
Yeah.
what did you say? How did you respond to that?
I didn't know how to respond. I just kind of looked at him like, okay, whatever. Were
you already dating at least? You were already dating at that point?
Yes.
We did, yes. Yes. We did.
I'm just so in love with that part of the story.
And it's funny because I come from a line of alpha females. So to have him, he's quiet by nature, but what he says, he says. And so for me, it was kind of like, "What? Okay, I'm going to do what? Oh, okay." So it was just that kind of thing. It was just really funny.
Oh, you could teach a class on that alone. And also, you're like the almost a baby of a large family too, right?
Yeah, 19 children. Yeah.
Oh, wow. I can't even imagine. And I have five sons, says a woman who has five sons, but I love them dearly.
Bless you.
Oh, I love them dearly. Okay, so let's kind of move it ahead because I know I want to play this clip so bad, but it's a lot of setting up I need to do because you were already singing with one of the top rated award-winning choirs. And you said you were how old? Because I think I may have misheard you.
I was 12. I started recording with Pastor John Key at 12 years old.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Wow. Okay.
So Cedric, have you always been in the music production side of it? Or are you also a vocalist or musician?
Yes, I actually started recording I was 14, actually. I was always, you know, drawn to the music production side of things in terms of, you know, the music in general. And I was one, you know, that always, even growing up as a child, you know, I was one that always read and was into the credits and, you know, always wondered how were sounds made, how were records made and the whole nine. So, I experienced my first recording at 14 and I was bit, you know, the bug got me. And from there, you know, that was my prayer, you know, to be not just a musician, but a producer as well. And God opened doors and here we are.
Oh my goodness. And did he open doors? So during that time, because you guys weren't together at 12 and 14, obviously, right? So you're on your side of the sphere doing your thing and seeing some success and some accomplishments. You're seeing your dream come to fruition. So when you all met, and now you have two amazing gospel artists, producers in the same household. Can you kind of paint that picture for me? Are you always singing and he's playing music, or are you saying, please stop so I can rest, and he's trying to continue to work? How does that work when you have this kind of talent under one roof?
Pretty much. It's a consistent, and now that we're empty nesters, it's a little bit easier. But when we had three boys as well, when they were all home, it was a consistent singing, music, everything. It's just always loud, always loud. So now it's still that, a little more tapered. I try to go to bed at a decent hour now. He still goes hours and hours. Okay, but some days, not so much.
Oh, wow. So when did you decide, LeJuene, that you wanted to, do you write music as well?
Cedric has coached me. I started years ago, and I'm still getting my feet wet and trying to understand the logic behind what I need to say. But I do. Yeah.
Okay. So this is the time where I'm just going to really kind of pause to kind of do a little station break here. And then we're going to come back and kind of introduce your other side of this triple threat that you have, LeJuene. And I want to get Cedric's feedback. And I know he was supportive, and I want to know how that happened. But we're going to take a break, and we'll be right back in just a moment.
Okay.
Show me something.
Wow. Okay. So you already having this amazing singing career, LeJuene. You have album after album out. And now, and I don't know when this happened, but you can tell me, when did you transition or discover that you had another amazing talent as an actress? Take me there.
Wow. It was the late 90s, I think 98, 99.
Yeah.
I had toured with A Good Man Is Hard to Find. And then I was cast in Woman Thou Art Loose with Bishop Jakes. Bishop T.D. Jakes. So I toured with that for a while. And then I did Mama, I Want to Sing off Broadway. And most currently, Donna Lawrence did a musical theater, Goshen, the musical, the theater production. And now Garrett Davis is Unforgettable. So I've done quite a few. So it started back in the late 90s. So God is real good.
Okay, I knew that could not have been your first play ever after I saw you. And then all these questions start going in my head. And we'll talk more about the play Unforgettable that is touring and and associated with G. Davis TV and the Alzheimer's Association. But I knew there was no way that was your first time, but I'm not shocked by what God does with a person. I'm a believer, true and true. I know anything is, he meant when he said Philippians 14, he meant what he said, right?
Yes, he did. Yes, he did.
He meant that. And so I wouldn't have been shocked, but I would have been a little surprised if that was your first play, because you play the mother and how you transition to be someone older and to have real adult children in this play. And then you had Alzheimer's. How did you go that deep inside to become Mama Dean?
Wow. Well, I will say that we have both been, we've experienced loved ones that have had Alzheimer's. Currently, my aunt, my dad's, well, she's the oldest living matriarch of our family. She has Alzheimer's. And we did experience that with another loved one that has passed on. So from those experiences firsthand, and then I did do a little research, just watching and trying to find some statistics to be as, you know, as accurate as I could, and to do what I could to bring that role to life. But yeah, from personal experiences though, that I will say that much.
Oh my, you embodied that character. And I promise you, I was literally crying, especially, you know, the scene where you were helping one of your wannabe daughter-in-laws to prepare this meal, and then the shrimp thing, and
oh yeah,
son is deeply allergic to it, he could have died. And you really felt that. And then my other, so Cedric, what were you thinking when she started being an actress? Because I mean, kids, what else, right?
So, well, actually, I already knew it was in her, you know, and as she stated earlier, she traveled with Good Man Is Hard to Find, and I had the opportunity to travel with that particular stage production as well. So with that, we traveling together, and I had the opportunity to see that side of her, and also to know that it was natural. You know, I had no problems actually, even with her, you know, going out with it, knowing that she would be able to fulfill whatever was put to her on the table and the whole nine, you know, because she's always been able to accomplish that, you know, that's been put before. And then, you know, my only, when I first heard about it, my only, concern was that, you know, her being with people that was integral. Oh, yeah. And you know, knowing Garrett and the crew there, yeah, you know, I felt good about her being with this particular production as well. And so my concerns wasn't that she would be able to pull it off, because I knew that she would. You know, again, you know, it was just making sure, you know, that she was with a good team.
Okay, so I'm just gonna, I'm all over the place with my, that's why I tell you it's a conversation. So, LeJuene, how difficult was it for you to be in the play called A Good Man Is Hard to Find when you living and doing life with a very good man? So how were you able to pull that off convincingly?
It was funny. And the ironic thing was I played the girlfriend. So
right.
It was a lot of fun. It was a lot of fun. That's how that had to be my approach with that one. Just have fun with it. And that's what we did. So and it was just fun because he was on the road. We both were on the road together. So we had fun with it.
Okay. So Cedric, have you been in a play with her?
So I was playing keyboards in that particular play with A Good Man Is Hard to Find. But in terms of on stage, no. That's not my role.
It's like
I stay in
No, the funny thing is when we say that, you know what's gonna happen down the road, Cedric. I'm just gonna go ahead and not that I'm a prophet or anything, but I'm gonna leave that there. Because I'll be buying a ticket to come see you debut in a play soon.
And that would be a miracle.
You know who specializes, right? What I tell you.
Come on.
Olivia's 4:13 all day. So LeJuene, what did your sons think about this when you were already doing, you know, you had your own albums, you were singing with these amazing choirs, you've been in these plays. What are your sons thinking about their mom?
They support. Actually, when I was on the road with Good Man for a while, two of the oldest two were on the road. And we've always, thank God, been able to take them with us as we traveled. So they love it. Our oldest son is in music himself. He's incredible. He's on tour right now with Charlie Puth. And I think he's programming for Chris Brown and Cardi B. He's doing a lot. Our middle son, he's doing his thing. Our youngest son, he's not so much into music, but he supports. So they have been tremendous. And they encourage me all the time. So I love my boys. They're grown men, but I still call them my boys.
Right.
I do too. My honey bunnies is what I actually call them. So we're going to pause again for a break. Because like I said, this will air on all across the country. And we have to do this right. So we're going to be right back in just a moment, everybody.
Okay. It's your life lit today. Have your troubles away. Maybe learn another way. Hanging with the
And I just noticed that was the clip that I talked about the cooking and the shrimp. And yeah. My son, I was telling my sons about that performance and how, first of all, it's one of those teaching plays. You know, usually you just go in to have a good time and you say, oh, that was a great play. You don't really remember what it was about other than like the plot. But with this, I've learned so much about Alzheimer's. I have a newer sense of sensitivity and compassion for caregivers and for children who have to watch their parents or anybody's loved one go through that. And so I was telling my sons about that. And like your oldest son, he was in such denial. And if I could say, I know which one of my sons, they were all probably would be, but there's my middle son who just will be just like that son. No, that's not my mom. Everybody forgets, you know, he keeps making excuses and not really wanting to face it and deal with it. And I thought he did an amazing performance as well. But your singing in that play, how you would go from being distraught as person dealing with Alzheimer's. And this is what studies prove too, that music is just something about music and singing, yes, for patients with Alzheimer's. So obviously you did your research. So tell me, was that difficult for you to go from one to the other?
I will say no, only because the moment in which each song appears, with The Amazing Grace, it shows the level of faith that Mama D has. And it comes from a place of, God, I really need your help. And she's worried at that point. She's concerned and she's pulling on her faith to get her through it. And then at the end with Smile, she's remembering moments with her husband, because at that point she doesn't realize that she's going in and out. So she's remembering happier times. And so each moment is pulling, the songs are pulling from those moments.
And I did recognize that the flow was of songs, and the song that took me out, and I want to talk with Cedric while we have a few more minutes in this segment, but that song when the guy from American Idol, your play son,
God,
Take a Look at Me Now, yes, he's, and how you were able to stay focused, like he wasn't singing that song to you at all, and that it meant nothing. I will never forget that scene, because I was waiting on you to show some kind of emotion, and it was like they had turned off your hearing and your yeah, your heart, because that guy sung that song. What were you dealing with?
It was so hard because of the moment he's realizing. I think for everyone after that shrimp moment, they're realizing that she's leaving us, and he's frustrated because he's saying that she won't get the opportunity to see me be the man that I'm becoming, that she kind of pushed him to, she kind of mentored and, you know, kind of loved him. You know how mothers can nurture other kids, you know, so she kind of helped nurture him to become the man that he was becoming. So he's frustrated and sad that she's slipping away and she's not recognizing who he's becoming.
Yeah, that was hard. That was hard for me to watch too. To even watch it. So I can't even imagine being able to perform it. So Cedric, when you are watching her sing and then perform, what's going through your mind? Because this is your wife, your rib. So, and I know you're super protective of all of that, but how are you maintaining your image and everything while you're watching her without being giddy? Like, that's my wife. Go girl, go babe.
Yeah, you know, I'm always, I tell everyone this, I'm always at all, you know, even when I see her up ministering or, you know, performing or, you know, just being in her element, because I hear her 24/7. She sings mm-hmm, all the time. And I guess one would think, you know, after hearing her sing so many times, you know, that I would just be used to it, you know, but every time she opens her mouth, again, I'll tell everyone, you know, I am still in awe, you know, of her, her talent, you know, of the awe that's on her, you know, and plus, you know, I know her to be a true prayer warrior at the same time, you know, so I see all of that, you know, and still being able to witness it, you know, firsthand, you know, to see her in her element on stage or whatnot, you know, I'm always in awe, you know, so she always keeps me on my toes every time because I'm listening, you know, to see what is she doing here, you know, what is she doing this, and then even in those moments when our singers, you know, sometimes singers may have a vocal day where they're challenged, but you know, to see her even being able to press through those moments, you know, and see how she overcomes on the other side of it, you know, even now I'm getting cheap, you know, so.
Oh, That is so good. And I have so many questions going to lead into our part two of this about the power couple and how you all balance life together and your challenges and still got to go on stage and perform. But I kind of want to stay there because we have another minute or so in this segment. So we're going to continue to talk about is Unforgettable. And the beauty of that play is the tickets are free. Alzheimer's Association and G Davis TV are making this available to get the message out for, to create awareness and also so that people of color understand that there are clinical trials that we can participate in. And of course, they address the, you know, the objections up front about the Tuskegee thing and the sickle, you know, the whole, what was it? Yeah, all of that. And then the other lady that we now know about, that how they were stealing her cells and all this stuff. And so it's a real thing. And the play not made up. It's real life circumstances. Somebody's life is, you all are portraying somebody's real life. So how do you deal with that pressure?
It is kind of somewhat difficult to balance. But I will say being a part of a family that has someone that currently has Alzheimer's, it is necessary. They are deeming this Alzheimer's epidemic as the silent epidemic or the silent killer for African-Americans. And I think Hispanics are the next leading after African-Americans. And so I just would pray and hope that everyone that comes would get the information and tap into the resources that are available to us, because I had no idea coming on board that there was this many resources available. So it's, you know, I feel honored to be a part of this because I do know so many people where the families are struggling through caregiving and who gonna watch mama today and trying to balance things and all of that. And they don't know that there are resources out there. So I'm grateful to be a part of it.
All right, so this is going to conclude this first part of the show, and then we're going to spend a lot of time talking about, you know, the trials, the ups and downs, and a lot of the triumphs of being a power couple in the gospel music industry. So everybody don't go anywhere. We'll be right back with more Cedric and LeJuene Thompson. All right, everybody. So what we're going to do, I'm going to let them have their pause for a second. And I'm just going to tell you, I'm so excited about today's show. We have an amazing couple on today, Cedric and LeJuene Thompson. I'm so hoping I'm pronouncing her first name right. But Mrs. Thompson, LeJuene Thompson, is an American gospel musician and artist. She started her music career in 2001 with the release of Soul Inspiration by EMI Gospel. This album was her breakthrough on the Billboard magazine charts, which it placed on the gospel albums and Christian albums. She's a member of the Tri-City Singers, and she is married to the Grammy Award-winning, Stella Award-winning music producer, Cedric Thompson, and they are our guest today. We've been talking about her career, how they met, and how he already knew she was his wife. She was his wife and was going to share his last name. And I love that story. So now we're going to talk about, you know, the audacity and the power and the ups and downs of being a power couple. So welcome back to the show, the Thompsons.
Thank you.
So I'm just going to jump right in. So when you all are, you have to go and perform regardless of what's going on, whether if your child is sick or you had a little hiccup in a conversation, there was some disagreement. So how are you able to focus? And this is for both you and Cedric. How are you able to focus on that song or that music and not worry about home without anybody knowing it?
You want to go first? Well, we learned early on to make prayer the focal point. No matter how mad we get with each other, and we do get mad with each other, studio sessions, sometimes he makes me so mad that I don't want to talk to him after we're done and he wants to go get something to eat and I'm still mad. even when we're upset, we still have agreed that we're going to pray together no matter what. No matter if he's on one side of the country or on one side of the world or wherever we are, we try to pray together. And I am convinced and I am certain that that has been what has held us together for 34 years. And we figured out again early on that we had to dance to the beat of our drum. You know, there's a reason why you can't take another person's prescription. There's a reason why a doctor won't give you, I can't take his prescription. He can't take mine. But what works for Sid and June was to get our kids, get somewhere, and we understood the order, God, family, and then everything else. We had some rough patches, but we learned it, and we learned it early. So I thank God that even now we get mad at each other. And I don't know what real marriage doesn't. So that's just us, and we always say, but keeping prayer as the focal point and communication, like, yeah. So he might have something different, but.
No, you pretty much said it. As she stated, you know, one of the main focus is that, you know, no matter what, you know, we always, make sure that we keep prayer at the forefront as well.
Yeah.
You know, and like she said, you know, no matter where we are, if I'm away or if she's away, you know, we make sure that at the beginning of the day and at the end of the day, you know, we're praying.
Yeah.
And we don't stay angry at each other long.
Not long.
You know, it, I mean,
we do go there, but we're not long.
Yeah, we'll go there. it may be for a few. And with that, you know, just like she said, you know, we may, one may even have the same medicine, but another dosage, you know,
yeah,
may do more harm to me.
Yeah, right.
You know, so right. Like she said, you know, we had to figure that out a long time ago, you know, to be able to walk into our path, you know, and understand who we are.
Yeah.
You know, and with that, you know, just make sure that we were able to keep a balance, you know, because doing ministry and doing, yes, music, you know, is hard, you know, number one, with time management with family.
Yeah,
very hard.
So we made sure that, number one, especially when our kids were in school, you know, that we were, at least one of us,
yes,
was there, you know, for their activities, because they were very active in school, you know, with sports and with our older son in music as well. That was always important to us. And yes, then, like she said, you know, at the end of the day, you know, staying out of people's business and keeping people out of our business.
Because when she said about the prescription, you can't take somebody else's prescription, there's a reason for that. I thought she was getting ready to go there. You can't take, because people want, they think it's a marriage looks like what it looks like. Everybody's right. Marriage is supposed to look a certain way. The mm-hmm. roles are supposed to be a certain way. Right. She's supposed to do certain stuff in you. And so when you said that about the prescription, it's different for everybody. I thought you were talking about as a totality of marriage, because that is, I was agreeing with what you said too. But I haven't been married, so I'm learning this, that keep people out to business, right? You just got to keep them out. But yeah, you know, when we get mad, we want to tell our friends, but we forget to go back and tell them we're okay. So now we're friends, okay. Friends and cousins, they still mad, right? So how do you, not that you have to deal with it, but how can we help couples to understand how damaging that is? Because we can't expect them to vote, because we're not going anywhere. We signed up for it. We're good in a relationship. But girl, absolutely, did you know he didn't come home? A girl, you know he did this. And now everybody mad at him. and right. we back in love with him. So how can we kind of help people to stop that and to see how foolish it is and damaging?
I think it comes with a level of maturity, actually, and a level of understanding what's important. Do I want all my friends mad at him because I'm mad at him and I'm being petty because there's two sides? You might not tell that you did what you did as well. Yeah. But I think it comes with a level of maturity and understanding how marriage really works, and that it's a union between two people and not a group of people.
Mm-hmm. Ooh, see, you said another word. Oh, that was good. It's a union with two people and not a group of people. I don't care what blood you share. That is, ooh, that's profound. See, you are teaching. You all are teaching. So while we're there, I want to stay here for a minute, if you don't mind, of giving this relationship advice, because and then we do want them to choose. We want them to choose when we, like, you mad at Cedric, he's mad at his Junie. And that's why you should bring people in like that. Share the ups, because you know everybody wants to be in the limo, right? When things are going well, they'll share that. But it is divisive when we start sharing. And I had to learn that too. I wouldn't tell my friend girls, you know, if I was dating or my sons, what I was, you know, when I was mad at them, and now they're like, ooh, wee. So you just gotta know, don't overshare, especially the downs.
Exactly. Don't overshare. And then I think another element to that as well is if you have those friends, you know, have those type of friends, you know, that are going to be, I mean, that you're going to be accountable to.
Right.
You know, so, and in that, you know, that plays to the element that LeJuene was speaking of as well with the maturity.
Yeah.
You know, having those around you that understand, okay, I know you did this, but what about the other side?
What's the other side?
You know, and then, and having those, you know, in your nucleus, you know, that's going to hold you accountable.
Yeah. And that will call if you being petty.
Absolutely. And then those people have to understand how critical their position is in your life, which means they can't be a yes girl or a yes dude. Exactly. You know, call me when I'm out of line. Because my brother, you know, we were in business running a restaurant, and I'm one of those people, if you say it needs to be done, I'm going to do it. Where he's a planner, he's methodical, and maybe it doesn't need to happen right now, but I'm going to go make it happen. He told me this one time, we were having this disagreement about him waiting too long and me moving too fast. He said, stand down, Loretta, stand down.
Brilliant.
And I respected it, right? Because I'm more mature. This was five years ago, and I still love, and that's why I said my husband's going to have that kind of empowerment from the Lord to tell me, you know, stand down, Loretta, or Loretta, say no. So, Cedric, both of you guys, do you have to tell him or you, June, tell him or Cedric her, say no, stop, you're doing too much. They will be okay if you say no. Tell me how you handle that.
He tells me all the time, no, say no, or just, you're not going to do that. So, and he's very quiet, but when he says what he says, he says what he says. So, yeah.
And with that, you know, I think even as a man, you know, even being open to receiving, you know, because again, you know, like she said, you know, we're one.
Yeah.
You know, so being open to receive, you know, that she has to share with me, you know, and not being so strong head, you know, and, you know, letting that man side of me, you know, kick in, you know, I can't receive instructions from you. No, you know, and because to be honest with you, you know, I wouldn't be the Cedric that I am today without her.
You vice know, versa.
We know each other's strengths.
Yes.
We know each other's weakness, you know, so prayerfully, you know, with the help of God, my strength helps to cover her weakness and vice versa.
Yes, it does.
You know, and we know how to operate in that, you know.
And that comes with maturity, like June said earlier. So let me ask this fun question. Somebody asked, they said, what brings the two of you joy as a couple?
Riding bikes.
Riding bikes.
We like riding bikes.
Watching movies.
Watching movies.
We love watching movies. We will
binge watch. If we find a good show, we will binge watch. Yeah. Yes.
And now we like making fun of each other too.
Yeah, clowning. We are. Yeah. It's our house always a prank or something.
And this may seem small, but we enjoy just taking joy rides.
Yeah, we just go you get know, in the car and ride.
No destination, yes. you know, just spending time with each other, just taking a ride.
Yeah, our joke is, I like you.
Is that?
Yeah, that's our joke. I like you, bud.
I love that. I'm taking notes, and I hope my husband, my future husband, is watching too, so he'll know. So when you say bikes, are you talking about motorized bikes or the kind you got to pedal yourself?
Pedal. Oh, no, pedal. Yeah.
Oh, yes. Yeah. Now that's so sweet and romantic.
Yeah.
So what's the most romantic date you all have ever had? Was it a picnic or was it some expensive? What's romantic and special for you all?
I think probably I remember I surprised her one time going out to it was near the water.
Yeah.
And we took a little picnic.
Yep.
You know, and
and it was spur of the moment.
It was spur of the moment.
Yeah.
You know, because there are times where we do a lot together. Mm-hmm. You know, so I wanted to be able to create a moment of something that to others may seem small, but, you know, something that has some thought into it as well. Yes. You know, so I think that was one of the most romantic outings for
us.
Yep.
Yeah. For us.
That is romantic. So let me ask you this. So what would both of you, and I want you to talk about when I ask the question, is relating to your career and your marriage. So what would your older self tell your younger self about your career? What kind of advice? And what would your older self tell your younger self about marriage?
Wow. Me, not to be so hot-headed, not to go from 1 to 10 and consider between. And that's with both the marriage and career, not to go from 1 to 10, consider the variables and consider what comes between 1 and 10.
I agree with that one. Or should I say, I'll take that one. and then also I think my older self would tell the younger Cedric to realize that you're not alone, and and to realize, you know, that you don't have to try to do this by yourself.
Wow.
You know, you have help, you know, and take the help, accept it.
That's good.
Ooh, I got to learn that one, Cedric, that I'm not, I'm so used to being an island, and it's hard to accept help because being raised by a stay-at-home mom who's very independent and prideful. Mm-hmm. We thought it was independence, but I'm looking at it now. It's definitely pride. You don't ask for help. You don't accept help. It's a weakness, but it's strength being able to say, I need help.
I think
that's the reason why we have so much trauma and mental illness in our communities, because we were taught that, and we didn't want people to see us cry. Man couldn't cry. Don't ask for help. Be hungry, but don't ask anybody. You know, just wait. Don't go out and do that. How can we help change that narrative? Is it more stories like this, or just telling people, you know what, that's not it's the opposite. Being weak is strength, and being too strong to say you're not weak, that's the weakness.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, with that, you know, just being in a place of not being afraid to be transparent.
Right.
And, you know, like you said, you know, for so long and I can speak, you know, for us or for me as a male, you know, you always, you know, wanted to show, you know, this strong side, you know, and thinking that, you know, showing, you know, a weak side of you, you know, or showing the man that has tears, you know, means that you're weak. No, No, you know, there's nothing wrong with being transparent, you know, because in that, you know, you will find, you know, areas where, you know, like I said, you know, those weak areas where you can strengthen those particular places, you know, those places, you know, that you may even find that needs healing.
Yeah.
As well, you know, so.
That's good.
Don't be afraid to be transparent.
Yeah.
Good. So we're just going to pause. I'm not going to play another video. We're going to pause so I can plug in more videos when we air. So we're just going to take a 5-second pause.
Okay.
All right, so we're back and we're still talking to Cedric, and now she's my friend, so I'm calling her June Thompson too.
That's what they call me, June.
June.
She is definitely my friend. So what's next for you guys artistically, corporately and individual? What's next for you all in your career? Cedric, if you want to go first, and then I want to hear about maybe if you all are working on something together that you can share.
Yes. So, corporately, that's one of the things that we're doing. You know, we're prepping for a release of a project that this time it includes it's always had both of us, but it includes the both of us being on the forefront.
Yeah.
So we're preparing for that. We've been doing a lot of speaking, you know, as it relates to marriages, you know, things of that nature. So I see those things, you know, opening up as well. Individually, of course, I'm still producing, and as of late, into scoring, you know, along with G Davis TV.
So I forgot, Cedric. I am interrupting, but I do apologize. What did you get your Grammy for? Can you tell us that, your Grammy and your Stellar Award?
Sure. It was Oh Happy Day project. That particular project was for a company, Vector Management, and they had this idea. At the time, on their roster, they had a list of A-list artists, and they had this idea to have each, well, not every one of them, but some of their artists to do gospel songs with a known choir or group put together, and so they got in contact with the record label in return called me to actually produced the project. So that name of that project is Oh Happy Day, and then there was a project behind that, Heather Headley.
Yeah. So he actually had two. He never says. Wow. I say it more than he does.
So you have two Grammys?
Yes.
One was super impressive, but two, oh my goodness. I bow.
They're collecting dust.
never. That's something no one can ever take away from you. And yes, scoring is huge. That's the kind of thing that we're familiar with in the big movies, you know, this music score behind these, like the Titanic and these historical classic, and music, and then those residuals and that money. You make money literally while you sleep, Ben.
Come on now.
So that's what I tell you. It's great to be in front of that microphone, but sometimes, you know, it's even more profitable to be behind, because everybody can sing that song and you still make money. So I'm just so happy to have shared this space and time with you all. We got a couple more minutes, so I do have some more questions. What else did they say? Oh, I wanted you all to finish the thing about what you're going to, you know, what are your next? And then June, you hadn't gone at all.
For me, of course, touring with Unforgettable, G. Davis Films and TV, and I'm so excited. Back in 2014, I started a nonprofit called Buttrfly Girls, and it's my way of paying it forward. As a teenager, I was arrested for stealing a Little Debbie cake. My cousin dared me to steal it, and I stole it. And she walked out with the cake. I got arrested and was labeled a juvenile delinquent. Had to be paired with a big sister And I'm the ninth of 10 children, but this lady, her name was Deborah. And I, if I could find her, I wish I could find her. But she introduced me. So I was brought up in, I'm trying to make abbreviated, brought up in a Christian home, and we weren't allowed to listen to what we call blues or R&B music. So she bought me a record by, Jennifer Holliday. And I was smitten. And just my whole experience with having a big sister, although I have big sisters, but that experience, she took me to different places that I had never been before. I wanted to pay it forward. So just from that experience of the whole being arrested and being labeled a juvenile delinquent and then being paired with a big sister, I wanted to do something. So that's what this group is for. Buttrfly Girls is for young women and girls, mainly at risk girls. But during my travels, I speak with a lot of women that are still hurting and still they're trying to find themselves. So we're relaunching that, and I'm so excited. September is coming soon, and that's when we will relaunch. We do a project called I Care for Hunger and Homelessness, and we bring a lot of my artist friends together, and we just bring donations, toiletries. In 2014, we did over $20,000 worth of goods, and we took them to different women's shelters, all kinds of shelters. So God is good. I'm just excited about it. We have a new garden initiative going for urban gardening called Jenny M. Gardens after my mom. It will teach ways to create sustainable food in small spaces. So I'm just excited. That's what I'm working on, and y'all stay tuned.
Wow. Gardening, nonprofit, and it's amazing how God uses, however God uses, to get us where we need to be and what we need in our life. So, and that's why he wants us to just be appreciative of everything, the good and those things that challenged us, because look what happened. He promises beauty for our ashes. And so Monica's trying to get me to talk about scoring. I guess she misunderstood my analogy of scoring. So, everybody knows that I know something, but I don't know everything. And that's why I love live shows, and I don't script, because I will not always know what I'm saying, but I mean
all
well.
Is well.
Oh,
yeah. All is well.
So you want to break it down real quickly for us, Cedric, what does scoring mean?
So basically, you know, as you stated, you pretty much stated it, you know, you're providing the backdrop musically, you know, of the piece, you know, whatever it is, you know, the film, whatever the piece is, you know, and so it entails you being able to set segues, mood, you know, musically, you know, and to play into the emotion of the film as well. So basically, you just
I was on the right path. I was on the right path. And she said, she was just reminding me that's where you left off. So, but I will admit, right, that I may say something incorrectly, and I'm the first to want to be corrected. So, Monica knows that it's accountability. We just talked about, right? Yeah, I don't want you all to have me out here saying something like, thinking Memphis is the capital of Tennessee, right? Don't say that, Loretta, because I know it's not true. I'm just using it as an example, right? So accountability doesn't mean yes to everything we say. It means correcting us with constructive criticism. I need that at this level, and you guys need that. We don't need yes people. Somebody said he did an outstanding job with My Family. And you all are seeing these hearts and these love. Everybody share this video, which will be on TV in 70% of the country as well. Yeah. But I can't believe we've almost talked our entire hour up.
Yeah,
and fun. I'm glad we talked about a lot, Cedric and June, but we had to get it out, because people think that's all you do. You just live this life on stage. Everything is wonderful. But you shared how you're giving back to the community in so many ways. And then your marriage, you shared about the hiccups and being mad and petty and that it wasn't perfect, but it's perfect for you. It's perfect for you. So you liberating other people to be okay and not try to measure and compare, because that's when we all lose. So Cedric and June, let's do some closing remarks. Tell me whatever you want to tell me. And thanks for being so transparent and vulnerable with me today.
Wow. Well, thank you again for having us. I just want to encourage everybody and get to the show. Unforgettable. Please come out. It is a powerful tool. Edutainment is what we call it. And I believe that those families that are struggling will find help and resources, and we can create a community, like, you know, just a hug or something. I don't know. But the shows that we've done, it's been tremendous. The response has been tremendous. And I think that if you do come and bring your family, that you will find what you need.
And just to add to that, be on the lookout for Said and June.
Oh yeah.
we have some new music coming out to you, and some other things that we'll announce in the near future. And I just want to add as well, you know, in all that you do, you know, be the best you that you can be.
Yeah.
You know, it's, I always say this, you know, it's good to be able to admire others, you know, maybe borrow from others, but make sure that you're not a counterfeit. You know, make sure
that's good.
Best you that you can be.
Yeah,
absolutely. You have got to come to Memphis. We'll have to figure this out. I want to say a big thank you, though, to Monica with MRE Media Works, who set the whole thing up. Yeah, Monica is so dynamic, and how she balances it all with all her different clients with different hats she wears and still look amazing in person when you see her. And I don't think she ever sleeps. So I just wanted to really say thank you, because without her, there would be no, this show wouldn't be happening. I wouldn't have been blessed with your talent and now what I call your friendship, both of you. If I can ever be of assistance, except for singing, you don't want me to come sing on nothing. Nothing. I can introduce something, though. I could do some vocal, some spoken stuff. But you all are a joy to talk to and to meet. And I know you have not even seen your best work yet.
Oh, wow.
Or your highest level yet.
Wow.
You still got that peak at that mountain, and it's going to be various ones. So I just want to say thank you.
Thank you.
And I believe in you. And keep sharing your story as often as you can, because it is very powerful and empowering and inspiring, and it makes a huge difference.
Wow. Thank you so much. Thank you. Appreciate it.
All right. So everybody, we're going to wrap this up. So as I always say in closing, think positive, dream big dreams, help someone along the way. And guess what? We'll see you all real soon. Goodbye, everybody.
Your life, this is it.